Let us discuss Chandrima Chakrabarty's essay, Bollywood Motifs, Cricket Fiction and Fictional Cricket. Now, as you know, film is a very dynamic and complex medium because it is unique in terms of the possibility that it provides. At the same time, film is both rigid and mobile. It is rigid in the sense that once it has been filmed, you know, you cannot change anything midstream. You'll have to reshoot it. It is mobile because not only are the people in the film or the characters in the film moving, the film per se can travel from one point or one place to another. It is sense oriented, but it is not tactile. In the sense that you can feel pity, you can be happy, you know, you can feel a sense of love or tragedy, but you cannot touch the characters on the screen. So it is sense oriented, but it is not tactile. It is not a medium that you can, you know, touch and feel and understand. And I would say that it is a revolutionary medium because all of these things set it apart from all the other agencies of visual culture. And films are a confluence of technologies. They are meant for mass consumption. They rely on repetitive patterns. They have artistic as well as utility value. So if you think about it, you know, if you go back to Adorno and Horkheimer's essay on the culture industry, films are one of those agencies that fulfill all those qualifications that need to classify it as a culture industry. So, you know, if you also look very carefully, the production values of a film are the same as those consumer-driven industries that one has come to expect from capitalism. Now, one of the most important aspects about films is that they create interpretive communities. Interpretive communities is a concept, you know, by Stanley Fish, where he talks about how, you know, audiences can view the same film differently or the same film in the same way. Okay, for example, you know, there'll be groups of people at film festivals. That's one of the best examples of an interpretive community where at film festivals people watch a certain film and, you know, they instantly form these interpretive communities, people getting together because they share the same wavelength about a particular movie, or you know, they disagree with each other's viewpoints. Now, what goes into the making of these interpretive communities is not just subjective, it is subjective on account of political, cultural, economic, social reasons or factors. See, any reader response, so to speak, is fashioned by all of these, you know, factors, which means that the way you interpret or analyze a film needs to be no different. Having said that, films are a very powerful cultural media, and they're also a very powerful economic tool, and moreover, they are a symbol of the soft power of a nation or a culture. Now, soft power refers to, you know, those intangibles that form the impression of one's country or one's culture or one's own self in the minds of the others. Okay, but we do not talk about soft power in terms of an individual to individual basis. We talk about it in terms of a culture to culture basis or a nation to nation basis. See, it's the power of soft power that decides how a country views another country, how their culture is received, how their traditions, customs and their people are received. Like, for example, you know, the dedication, the focus, the single-mindedness of the Japanese, that is one of those, you know, intangibles. You don't know that, but that is the impression that people have of Japan, which then translates into, you know, automatically assuming that the machinery they make, the technologies that they produce, they all will reflect that particular characteristic, that is, that we assume is a characteristic of the Japanese people. So that's an example of soft power. So yes, films are also a symbol of soft power, which is why sometimes, you know, certain films are often criticized as presenting the wrong picture of a nation. Okay, like for example, with Pather Panchali, where Satyajit Roy was supposed to be dealing in poverty porn. Okay, and there's also the example of Slumdog Millionaire, if you want a recent one. Slumdog Millionaire, where people said that the movie won the Oscar because it showed India as a poverty-stricken land, and you know, the use of the word slumdog itself was objected to. This leads me to also tell you that films are an effective tool of propaganda. Films were used in the past very effectively by the Nazi regime in order to, you know, tell the German people about the advances that the Führer was making, about the glory of the German, you know, empire and so on. And people just lapped it up. They believed it all that was being presented. Then, you know, you have the example of the movie 300 starring Gerard Butler that talked about, you know, the Spartans, 300 of them facing a huge army from, you know, Xerxes, the king of Persia at that point of time. And the way that Xerxes had been presented as a rather effeminate, rather degenerate, debauched character had raised the heckles of Iran, who then took the matter up to the United Nations and said that this kind of portrayal should be actively discouraged. So, you know, movies do become a tool of propaganda. And, you know, in places where liberty is restricted, movies are seen as a symbol of defiance. And commercial cinema is a very potent economic agency. You know, there is literally a lot of money in commercial cinema, which is a popular cinema. And, you know, generally we could say that films have also redrawn or redrafted or reimagined the paradigms of what can be called a text. At one point of time, only books could be called texts. You know, people would do their dissertations only on novels or poems or so on. But with the passage of time, you know, paintings, particularly movies again, became, you know, also began to be considered as texts. So it redefined the paradigms of what can be called a text. Now, before proceeding any further, let's look at the profile of the author, Chandrima Chakraborty, whose areas of interest include South Asian literatures and cultures, postcolonial culture studies, Bollywood cinema, literature, film, media, and masculine performances, particularly in Hinduism, you know, and how it is that, you know, Hinduism is a very important site or agency in the performance of masculinity. So all of these have formed her areas of interest, which means that this essay that she has presented to us, Bollywood Motives, Cricket Fiction and Fictional Cricket, is a culmination or coming together of most of her areas of interest. Now let's move to the structure of the essay. It is rather straightforward. She contextualizes Bollywood and gives it a kind of a historic emphasis, you know, talks about the difference between art cinema and popular cinema in India and the various avenues that are there for the same. And then she contextualizes Bollywood, talks about the importance of Bollywood as an industry, as a cultural icon. Because as we all know, there are, you know, films are very popular in India, with stars occupying larger than life persona. You have the cult of the Indian superstar. It is really massive. You know, you have examples ranging from Rajesh Khanna, Amitabh Bachchan, N.T. Rama Rao, there is MGR, Khushbu, Shah Rukh Khan, Mohanlal, Mammootty, to name just a few. So, you know, at one point, films go beyond just being entertainment to being cultural ambassadors. And we take our films very seriously in India. And the other side of this essay, cricket, is just as important to the Indian public. We are one of the, let's say, biggest fans of cricket there are in this world. And, you know, Chandrima Chakraborty places cricket in the Indian cultural context, where she compares it to a religion. And as we know that famous statement, cricket is my religion and Sachin is my God. And, you know, fans of cricket sometimes take it a bit further and resort to hooliganism when their team is losing. Like once what happened at the iconic Eden Gardens, where India was playing and we were losing pretty badly, and people began to throw plastic bottles and so on onto the ground in great anger. And our cricketers are seen as nothing less than demigods. So you have the example of Sachin, you have Dhoni, you have Virat Kohli, who not only are great players and they also endorse a number of brands, so you know they have economic value also, but they also have cultural value. Their stories are seen as those that have to be emulated by our youth. So you know, when we look at that, we realize that cricket is not just a sport in India, it is a part of our cultural behavior. So that is why a number of movies have been made on cricket itself. You have Awwal Number, you have Iqbal, you have Azhar, you have Kai Poche, you have Dhoni, The Untold Story, the movie that was coming up, 1983, starring Ranveer Singh. You have all of these movies. And see, these are all, you know, sport movies, and movies that are based on sports generally have this characteristic that they always present the story of the underdog. And how an underdog overcomes all of these difficulties and goes on to win a major tournament or a major match, something like that. You have Dangal as an example there. You know, lots of movies on sports, Chak De India and so on. The movie made on Milkha Singh, Bhag Milkha Bhag, all these movies. Okay. Now, if you look at it, you know, Chandrima Chakraborty says, Lagan is a coming together of both. And I say both, I mean Bollywood as well as cricket. Okay, so that means that it is this unbeatable combination. So basically, you know, this essay is one that discusses the perception of Lagan. That is, what is the cultural and critical relevance of Lagan is what Chandrima Chakraborty wishes to discuss. Now, what she does is that she also, you know, while talking about Lagan, talks about how the subalterns manage to destabilize the history of colonial cricket. So in her own words, thus this essay is about subaltern classes and modernizing devices such as cricket and cinema, which depending on the historical and social context can enable or disable the subaltern's entrance into history. The subaltern classes and the subversion of the civilizing mission of the British imperial enterprise through Lagan's representation of cricket in the colony. So simply put, you know, it tells you the ways that, you know, those people who had been kept out of cricket, that is namely Indians, and within those groups subalterns, have made a re-entry, have come from the margins right into the center through the agency of this film. And also, you know, cricket, which is supposed to have origins in England, was a symbol of their culture. It was something that they are immensely proud of. And, you know, by these subalterns managing to beat them at their own game, you know, the whole modernity project also starts to become rather fragile. It becomes disrupted. We will come to that some more. Now, Chandrima Chakraborty goes on to say that Bollywood, on account of the kind of influence that it wields, helps the Indian masses to drop that colonial hangover, that colonial subjecthood, and embrace their Indianness, to revel in the sense of who they are. So, you know, the post-colonial possibilities of this transformation are immense, because it will help us cross the barriers of caste and class that had been enforced over the decades due to colonial modernity. See, I'm not saying that India was a casteless or a classless society, but, you know, with the coming of the British and, the establishment of, you know, certain social norms and methods of enumeration like the census, what began to happen was that, you know, these social classes, these cultural classes began to get solidified. They began to become rigid, you know, they began to become inadmissible spaces, which then ended up keeping a lot of people out. So, you know, through Bollywood, through talking about all of these things, these people can come back and rightfully claim their place. That is what is being said here. And also, you know, Bollywood can construct imaginative communities, the term that we discussed earlier, within the rural classes, that will be able to bring into normal, into everyday conversation, the, you know, questions of caste and class and, you know, destabilizing colonial structures. So it kind of, you know, helps intellectual conversations come into spheres that they are normally kept out of. The story of Lagan is inspired from an incident that had actually taken place. So in the movie, the villagers of Champaner are reeling under a massive drought, and they decide to petition the king, their Raja, not to impose taxes on them that particular year. So they go to the Raja's palace and find that there is a game of cricket going on between the white men, and there is this protagonist of the movie, Bhuvan, that's played by Aamir Khan, who tries to explain this game to the villagers, and he says that, you know, it is just this local game that our children play called Gilli Danda. This is just another version of that, it is no big deal kind of a thing. But the British officer overhears him and gets very, very offended that, you know, his game, the symbol or power of the empire, that is how he sees the game as, is being made fun of by a poor villager. So he makes a bet, you know, and also we should understand that the Raja tells the people that it is not within his power to reverse the taxes. The British are the ones who have imposed this tax, which means that it is then that the British, the Indians come to know that even their master has a master. So anyway, the British officer makes a bet. You know, he says that if you beat us at this particular game, then we will waive your taxes. You don't have to pay your taxes. But if you lose the bet, then we will impose 3 times the normal tax on all of you. So, you know, this bet indicates the cultural superiority of the white man on account of the gentleman's game, you know, the game that he plays. That game that he plays itself becomes a rather strong point of his identity, which he can't then bear to see derided by somebody he considers far below him. Okay, so this film looks at subaltern identities in majoritarian projects. Now, you know, the end of the movie, you know, the protagonist Bhuvan, he brings in a ragtag team, various people in the village itself, they come together and they train, and, you know, there are differences. Much of the movie talks about the dynamics between these people. But the end of the movie where, you know, the Indians win against the British, it is a symbolic representation of the post-colonial aspirations. Because obviously this movie was made after independence. So, you know, even when in the pre-independence era, Bhuvan and his friends are winning, it is actually a symbol of our post-colonial aspirations. Okay? So, it also helps to relocate the subaltern subject from the margins to the center of a popular sport. And it corrects the notion that subaltern subjects are unable to write and thereby create their own history. Now, you know, it is often said that, you know, the subalterns don't have the agency to write their history because there was not much history to be talked about. Because if you look at the Indian independence movement, everybody seems to believe that it was just the Indian National Congress that had, you know, struggled to get us our independence. But they people keep missing the point that there have been these, you know, smaller struggles, peasant uprisings and so on in various parts of the country, that the Congress has come and taken over, you know, subsumed under its wing, which means that, you know, those stories never got told. So movies like Lagan help these untold stories to come to the forefront. It encourages people to go looking for more of these stories so that they can be told the way that they should be told, and that the subalterns don't have to remain on the periphery. They can write themselves back into history. Lagan is very relevant because it is a very interesting way of bringing subaltern histories into focus. That's what Chandrima Chakraborty also points out. And the movie also resists colonial assimilation by making subaltern narratives more prominent, because a lot of time, a lot of effort is invested in showcasing the villagers, their lives, their problems, their interpersonal relationships and so on, rather than focusing on the, you know, the Raja or the colonial administration or even humanizing them for that matter. None of that happens. Then the movie also helps to provide a way, an alternate way of reading mainstream history by pointing out the gaps, the erasures, the absences, the lack that could be there. And also, the movie helps the subalterns have their own agency. That is, they find out on their own, through their own intelligence, that their true enemy is not the Raja, but the British. Now, why this becomes important is that often it is construed that the subalterns cannot think for themselves. They have to be thought for. Someone has to suggest that this is how things are, and they are just natural followers. But here what we see is that not only, you know, they come to this conclusion on their own, they are also natural leaders. So, you know, the movie sets out to unravel, to unspool all those things that we have been learning. It is a process of unlearning. This movie is a process of unlearning all of that. And, people generally romanticize villages. They say, oh, that is where the simplest, and nicest people live. They are purest of heart. They are great and so on. But, you know, you see that, you know, in this village, there are layers of people, you know, and there are layers to their character. It's a very complex kind of honeycomb of a structure, because there are issues of caste, there are issues of gender, you know, there are issues of power structures within this particular village. Okay, so like I said earlier, the villagers realize that it's not the king but the British who is their true enemy, which means that there is a siding with the Raja. There is a bond of solidarity that is established with the Raja. But this is something very, very temporary. We'll be coming to that shortly. Because, you know, all said and done, the power relations between the peasants should not be forgotten. Even they will not forget it, despite the feel-good victory that comes at the end. And, in the movie, again, we see that there is something called a strategic alliance that is being formed, okay, which is an alliance, or let's say a relationship that is formed on the basis of a need. There's a certain need, and that is why a certain relationship is formed. The best example there is that of Kachra, you know, the supposedly lower caste individual who is also disabled, but you know, he is brought into the team not for anything else but because he is exceptional. So see, what would have been a matter of automatic selection if he had been an upper caste, you know, he has to be that much more exceptional in order to be a part of this particular cricket team. In fact, he himself could not believe that they were asking him to join them. You know, there's a statement that he says, I am an untouchable. And they say, yeah, we know, but you know, we need to win this. So see, at the point where there is a greater goal, an economic benefit, so to speak, then these class, caste, gender divides no longer exist. Okay. And you know, that is the case that I was mentioning with the Raja also, that they form the temporary alliance. But what we have to understand is that if the Raja takes the tone of the British at one point of time, he too will face this kind of a political resistance on the part of the villagers. So, you know, when you think that, oh, this is a movie that talks about patriotism and being Indian and so on, Chandrima Chakraborty talks about Sudipta Kaviraj, who says that there is no connection between being patriotic and being Indian. You know, those are two different things. So in this movie, what they were doing was that for the sake of an economic benefit, for the sake of their pride, they were playing against a set of people that who had been playing this game for a long time. So it cannot be that, you know, there was no opposition to this idea, that people were seriously worried what would happen if they lost and so on. You know, there would have been a number of let's say oppositions, but all of that is shown as smoothened over. It is shown that everybody, all of the village and all of the surrounding villages, everybody was invested in this particular project because it was a way of showing the white man. But the reality remains that it is about the economic benefit that they were looking for. Some of the observations that can be made with regard to this essay that, you know, Chakraborty also points out, and some of them are personal observations also, that is, the subaltern movements through the ages, Chakraborty feels, they have not been able to sustain their momentum and become something bigger. You know, even that is true even in today's case, where a lot of subaltern movements are erupting at a local level, but they don't connect with each other and become a kind of a massive compelling movement. That time is yet to come. So that's what, you know, she also points out, that there have been uprisings which have subsided without going in for a larger goal. You know, what does the subaltern want? How does the subaltern get heard? All of these things are determined by the direction that these mass movements are supposed to take. Now, in this movie, you know, they met the goal of waiving the taxes. Then what? But it's at that point that the movie just ends. Now, the subaltern presence destabilizes the oppressor's political agency. Okay? Because, you know, by deriding their game, what happens is that by doing so, it not only de-glamorizes the white man's cricket, but it also, you know, kind of cuts down the mighty empire to the level of grown men playing a children's game. Now, how silly is that going to look? So suddenly what seemed like a very active, very masculine sport becomes grown-up men chasing after a ball after, you know, slapping it with a stick. That's what it becomes. So it kind of destabilizes the oppressor's vision of himself as a symbol of power. And it also shows the reverse flow of power. See, the game of Indian village children that is borrowed by the empire. And finally, a group of ragtag Indian men are able to defeat the mighty officers of the British Empire. So what happens is that in that public space, it is not, you know, villagers just winning a victory. It is also showing the white man that they cannot be oppressors, that they cannot be their rulers, that kind of a thing. But one of the glaring absences in the movie is that of women. You know, women are reduced to being romantic love interest, the mother figure. Then, you know, you have Elizabeth, who is a sister of the British officer. Now, she is a rather interesting study because, you know, being a woman, she is kept out of the game, thinking that, you know, she can't play. A number of women in the village are also, you know, not included because they are women. So those gendered spaces in which cricket can be performed becomes very, very significant and very obvious also. So Elizabeth, what she does is that because, you know, the men in her race don't allow her to play, she comes down and starts coaching the Indians. So see, it is, and they have no objection to that either. You know, they are like, they're fine with that. You know, they in fact prosper under her. So, you know, you can see that there is a lot of strategic alliances that are being formed throughout the movie. And of course, it is a matter for the interpretive community to read the film and form their own impressions of these things. But anyway, the movie also, you know, kind of places into perspective the ideas of fair play, because the British are supposed to be extremely fair-minded, but in this case they, you know, did resort to a lot of underhand techniques. Then it is also a study in masculinity, like I told you earlier, and it links subaltern politics to sports culture. So, you know, it says that, you know, glory in sports is a way of writing oneself back to the center from the margins. So in short, the game in the film becomes a study in racism, class differences and performances of all of these. Okay, now, you know, the film is basically not about who invented cricket, because there have been some critics who have congratulated the filmmaker Ashutosh Gowarikar for talking about who actually invented cricket, where did it originate and so on. But it's not basically about that. What it is about is the need for making these spaces democratic, for bringing erased subaltern presences in political and social movements, you know. And it shows the difference between the ideal and the British citizen. In conclusion, we can say that Lagaan presents an interesting approach to dealing with history by showing alternate histories and participants. And the medium of film and cricket, you know, their coming together ensures that these stories get told far and wide. They are accessed by literally millions of people. So, you know, what a book might take decades to do, this film could have just done it in a matter of weeks. Then, of course, there is this whole presence of the other in the film, that is the untouchable, the disabled, the women. All of them are also there to serve to disrupt the popular notions surrounding the freedom struggle. So what this movie also helps to make us understand is that all of these people were also part of the freedom struggle. It was not just fought by able-bodied men from the upper classes and upper castes, you know. These struggles were happening at very grassroots levels, at very basic levels, that it was everybody's project, not just, you know, of this elite set of human beings. And this helps populate history with a lot more characters, with a lot more people, and makes history polyphonic, which is a very good thing, because history is meant to be elastic. It is supposed to be able to expand and absorb all of these, you know, factors, all of these people, all of these characters. A rigid history is one that becomes oppressive, that becomes a manifesto rather than a reference point. And, you know, popular cinema, Lagaan has shown us, can be made a very viable avenue to bring out discussions on class, caste, gender and subalternity, you know, to a very, very common sphere. It can be used to destabilize monolithic, oppressive structures. Thank you.